The solar system is made up of one star, a handful of planets, more than 100 moons, millions of rocky asteroids, and billions of comets. All these bodies revolve around the sun because of the gravity of the sun. Gravity of the sun is a force that pulls the objects toward the center of the sun. The sun is the only star in our solar system. It is a huge ball of fire shooting light and heat in all directions. No living thing can survive without the sun. All the planets and the moons use sun rays for their light. There are 8 planets in our solar system. They are Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Earth is the planet where we live. It is the 3rd planet from the sun, after Mercury and Venus. Earth is the 5th biggest planet of the solar system, but all the planets are tiny in comparison to the sun. It takes 365 days to revolve around the sun. Earth looks blue from space because it is mainly covered by water. Earth has one moon. There are many planets that have more than one moon. The moon revolves around the Earth as well as the sun. It takes 24 hours to revolve around the Earth. The moonlight we see from Earth is the light from the sun. There are some small rocky bodies in the solar system that have been left over from the formation of the planets. These are called asteroids. Asteroids don't have enough gravity to pull them into the shape of a ball. Most of them lie in between Mars and Jupiter. Comets are balls of rock and ice that grow tails as they approach the sun. Comets come from far away, an imaginary place at the edge of the solar system. As it moves closer to the sun, the glowing tails are visible.
Crushing the globe. We've all been raised with the preconceived paradigm wherein our world is a sphere spinning around the sun, hurling through space on a wobbly axis in the Milky Way galaxy. We're taught to believe this is self-evident, and we are programmed to assume that anyone who says otherwise is crazy, stupid, or simply doesn't understand physics. This video was produced to prove that the spinning globe model is actually rife with contradictions and is also demonstrably false. If you're not familiar with the scientific method, it goes something like this. 1. You develop your hypothesis or your theory. Then you test your hypothesis using verifiable facts. Now, if one single fact contradicts your model, then you must either A, account for the contradiction in your model, or refine your hypothesis to account for these facts, or B, abandon your model altogether if the facts or one single fact simply doesn't jive with your model. People have been trained to buck the scientific method when it comes to the spinning globe in their mind. Instead of rethinking their model, they try to apologize for the facts which disprove the model. And I'll get into several facts which prove the world is definitely not a spinning globe. But first, I want to highlight a few items about the globe model, which are huge coincidences we simply cannot ignore. If you're familiar with forensics, if a theory seems too unlikely, it's too off the wall or just too much of a coincidence, too chance. If any circumstantial evidence is also highly unlikely related to this theory, then your theory or the scenario that you're testing against the facts is, by definition, highly unlikely. Okay, so one coincidence, the sun and moon appear identical in size. So the sun is supposedly 93 million miles away, exactly 400 times larger than the moon, and 400 times further away. The fact that the sun and moon are identical in size when standing on planet Earth is one big, huge, astronomically unlikely coincidence that is asserted in the globe model as a relatively mundane factoid. So this one single coincidence isn't enough to say that the globe model is wrong, but it's enough to raise an eyebrow if you're a forensic investigator as a highly unlikely coincidence. The fact is, we can use Euclidean geometry to accurately estimate the distance to the sun by measuring the angle of the shadow cast by the sun at high noon for multiple points simultaneously with miles in between each point. Using this method, we can accurately estimate the distance and the size of the sun. But you need to have one of two assumptions going into the experiment. Either A, the Earth is a sphere, or B, the Earth is a plane or a flat surface. So once you've taken the measurements and plug in the numbers into the equation, you'll find that you can arrive at two completely different answers depending on the assumption going into the experiment. So A, if the Earth is a sphere, then the sun is 93 million miles away. That's 93 million with an M. Or B, the sun is about 3,000 miles away if you factor in the assumption going in that the Earth is a plane or a flat surface. Now, both answers are technically, mathematically correct. However, only one is the truth. Now, we can observe several characteristics of the light from the sun, which proves that it cannot possibly be 93 million miles away. A couple of examples of this are hot spots on the tops of clouds, convergent rays of the sun when viewed as sunbursts through clouds, and then of course the path of the sun through the sky when observed standing on the Earth is a straight line and not a curved line, which you would expect to see if it was the spin of the Earth which caused the setting of the sun. Furthermore, whenever we sit near a body of water around sunset, you'll notice a hot spot coming from the sun traveling across the entire body of this water ending at your feet. Now, if you think about the angles involved here, the sun was indeed 93 million miles away. It couldn't possibly display this behavior, as the light should bounce way out into space and not appear to come right to your feet. It's kind of hard to illustrate this, but I'll try. So, another big coincidence. Gravity is the perfect force to negate the outward push of the spin. So, another major astronomically unlikely coincidence regarding the globe model has to do with gravity happening to be sufficient to perfectly balance us stuck to the Earth as it spins an arbitrary 1,000 miles per hour plus near the equator. Now, it might seem logical and not that wild of a coincidence that 1G is perfectly balancing us with the weight of the world pushing up on your feet at over 1,000 miles per hour near the equator. Now, gravity is supposedly caused by the mass of the world warping space-time, and in response to this warp, space-time sort of pushes back down on the planet. So gravity is supposedly based entirely upon the mass of the Earth. And it's balancing us in an opposite force to the outward thrust generated by the spin of the Earth, which is something completely different than the mass, and the two are not mutually related. So, now that the spin of the world, you know, is totally arbitrary, it could be spinning twice that fast, or it could be spinning half that fast. It doesn't have to be spinning once every 24 hours. So, in the first scenario, if it's spinning twice as fast, with 1G, or the size of the Earth, so if a planet our size was spinning twice as fast, we would be flung from the Earth at 1,000 miles per hour near the equator, as gravity would be sufficient only to hold us down if the Earth is spinning 1,000 miles per hour, but not 2,000 miles per hour. Okay, so gravity simply would not hold us to the Earth in this scenario. Now, in the latter scenario, where the world is spinning half as fast, we would weigh twice as much and probably be squashed like a bug, although we would have quote-unquote evolved a little bit differently, so maybe that wouldn't be such a big deal. I suppose we could get used to that. However, the point is clear. Luckily, we're spinning at the perfect speed near the equator to balance us perfectly with the amount of gravity generated by the mass of the Earth. Now, this is a huge, astronomically unlikely coincidence regarding the globe model. Furthermore, the globe isn't spinning uniformly in terms of speed, so if you're standing very near the axis or the North Pole, you'd only be spinning less than a mile per hour. So the theory of gravity actually falls apart here, since we've traveled to the North Pole and people weigh exactly the same as they do near the equator. So this is not only proof of a wild, unrealistic coincidence, but it also proves gravity is a load of shit. Coincidence number three. We only see one face of the moon. Yet another major, highly unlikely coincidence regarding the globe model. The conventional accepted model asserts that we can only see one face of the moon due to its geosynchronous orbit, which means it's rotating around us with the perfect amount of speed and related spin to ensure that we only see the one face, ever. So if you think about this logically, it truly is highly unlikely that this would occur in a natural random scenario. Indeed, you would have to be very lucky to have such a relationship with your moon wherein only one face is ever visible to you forever. Since the true correct model, the flat Earth model, doesn't need gravity, the relationship between the Earth and our moon seems to be more of the electromagnetic variety. Think about the fallacy of the globe model for a minute. The moon is supposedly so far away that it can safely orbit the Earth without being sucked into the event horizon of the pull of the Earth's gravity. Now keep in mind, the Earth's gravity should be about 6 times higher than that of the moon. So how is it possible for the moon to be well beyond the event horizon of the Earth's gravity, but the waters in our oceans are somehow within the pull of the moon's gravity? This is totally counterintuitive and literally makes absolutely no sense. You cannot have both in this scenario. Either the moon is close enough to have its gravity pull on the oceans, or the moon is so far away that it's beyond the event horizon of the Earth's gravity. But you cannot have both. It's illogical. So now at this point, forensically speaking, we have 3 very highly unlikely coincidences that need to be factored into the probability of the globe model. So just to recap the 3. 1, the sun and the moon are identical in size due to a highly unlikely optical illusion. 2, gravity is perfectly balancing us with the spin due to sheer chance. And we only see one face of the moon due to the chance geosynchronous orbit. Okay? So any forensic investigator at this point should have an eyebrow or two raised, as you need to multiply these unlikelinesses of all the factors. But we'll continue because this has only just begun. So number 4 coincidence, the North Star in alignment with our North Pole. Okay, so since the North Star Polaris has been the guiding star for navigators throughout history, we can surmise it's maintained this alignment for some significant duration. This is indeed a huge coincidence that any one star would maintain alignment with our North Pole. Actually, it proves that we could not possibly be standing on a spinning globe orbiting the sun on a wobbly axis. In order for the North Star Polaris to maintain such an alignment with our North Pole, it would need to be traveling back and forth through space millions of light years and ensuring that it stays directly above our North Pole at all times. This is simply not possible. It's not improbable, so I shouldn't even have counted it here as a coincidence, because it's impossible. Again, this is a forensic analysis of the globe model, which is looking more and more like a big fat lie, forensically speaking. Number 5 coincidence. No flights ever traverse the South Pole. Quotes,
South Pole.
This day and age, you'd expect to have a booming tourist industry or at least corporate mining expeditions to the Antarctic or the South Pole. Did you know that all international flights that should enjoy a short flight with a direct route over the South Pole or even near it never take the direct route and end up transferring all over the world in order to make it to their destination? No one has ever flown around the globe going south around Antarctica, and no one ever will. This is because there is no South Pole and we don't live on a globe. It's impossible to travel around the South Pole because the South Pole doesn't exist. Number six coincidence, the relative sizes on the maps are all wrong. Another major coincidence that is highly unlikely is the fact that modern maps are all wrong in terms of relative sizes of continents. You can fit Canada twice in the length of Russia, and Greenland is many times larger than it appears on the map based on the globe model. Indeed, these inaccuracies are apparent on a toy globe. So, how do you explain the mapmakers getting all the relative sizes wrong when transferring information from a globe to a smaller globe? The fact is, they have extrapolated relative distances based on the assumption that we live on a globe, and so the numbers are all wrong. I suppose you believe it's a big coincidence that we can't get the relative sizes of the continents correct on the maps. Number seven coincidence. One picture of the Earth from NASA. One. So we've got one single picture of the Earth, quotes Earth, from space, in all its glorious sphereness. We've spent literally trillions of dollars on our space programs. We only ever see composite cartoons of our world. And the one single image we have was proved as a fake image by NASA. They took this picture from a window of one of the Apollo missions, on which they lost all of the footage of the moon landings. So many strange, unlikely coincidences involved with the globe model, eh? If I were a forensic detective, I would have the fucking globe in cuffs right now. The globe should have a full body cavity search performed by Corrections Officer Bubba. Seriously. Number eight coincidence, the Big Bang. According to the globe model, our entire universe exists because of one big coincidence known as the Big Bang. You see, according to this model, nothing exploded and created the entire universe. Fairly big, unexplained, highly unlikely coincidence. You'd expect to see new universes or new Big Bangs all the time. Number nine coincidence, strange visitors from other worlds. So we're told that the visitors many people are witnessing and filming, who seem to possess zero gravity craft, are somehow traveling through millions of miles for millions of years from faraway galaxies. This is a huge coincidence that's really not explained very well in the globe model. It seems like they're covering this up because it's far more likely that the visitors are coming from another node in the infinite plane which we dwell. So rather than traveling for millions of years and happening upon our little speck of a planet, they probably just traveled across their retaining wall. Coincidence number 10, the United Nations logo is a flat Earth map. One of the biggest coincidences of all, what are the odds that the UN would pick the flat Earth map as their logo if we lived on a sphere Earth? Number 11, all the world powers must keep us out of Antarctica. The fact that our governments do not want us exploring the outer retaining wall known as Antarctica, how can you explain the fact that you cannot bring or store fuel anywhere near the Antarctic, and according to the 1950s Antarctic Treaty? In the uber-capitalist, oil-addicted, gold-loving world that we all know so well, we should be mining the shit out of Antarctica by now. They don't want us going there because they don't want us knowing there's probably more land out there beyond the Antarctic. Number 12, perfectly vertical buildings from 50 plus miles away. We've all seen the videos of how buildings can be seen from over 50 miles away. Perfectly vertical, perpendicular to the horizon, and perfectly visible. How can you explain this coincidence? As a building from that far away should be angled away from your perspective, as it should be founded upon a distant edge of a curve. All the old wives' tales state that the ships traveling beyond the horizon disappear with their bottom facing you. However, this is simply not what we observe in reality. We have excellent telescopic cameras nowadays, and we can see ships going beyond the horizon, perfectly perpendicular to the horizon, and not angled away from your perspective, and not bottom last. So, to talk about the true correct model a little bit, and get away from the bountiful, myriad, of unexplained coincidences surrounding the globe model, and really a lot of them are actually just flat out proof that the globe model is wrong, but we'll call them coincidences since many people are simply not convinced yet. The flat earth model, all of the heavenly bodies are orbiting the magnetic center of the known universe, which is fixed at our north pole, the magnetic center. Since we live on a flat earth, a compass needle will always be attracted to the center of the world, not the top of the globe. This attraction to the center is apparent even when in the southern hemisphere. So the heavenly celestial bodies are orbiting us and we're stationary. This means there's some type of force causing these bodies to be weightless and orbit us. I think the ancient builders were probably aware of this principle, and it explains how they were able to build structures such as the pyramids. If you're familiar with the Coral Castle down in Florida, a single man built a castle made of extremely heavy rocks very quickly and with almost no help or machinery. He never disclosed his method, but I suspect it had something to do with this magnetic energy that causes the moon and the sun to orbit us. Indeed, I believe that Nikola Tesla was aware of this force, and so he was able to invent free wireless energy and wireless communications, but more importantly, wireless energy, well before the internet was even close to being theorized. So even newfangled zero-point energy fields, which are being researched by very fringe scientists, seems to be akin to this electromagnetic force, which is causing the celestial bodies to orbit us. Who knows? Also, the relationship with the Earth and the Moon is demonstrably of the electromagnetic variety, and certainly nothing like gravity would explain, without all the major coincidences, of course. So, if the Moon is orbiting us in response to an electromagnetic phenomena, it makes a lot of sense that one face of the Moon would be attracted to the face of our world, and that would perfectly explain that one face being ever present. Furthermore, since the Moon is a lot closer in the flat Earth model, it makes sense that its electromagnetic pull would affect the world's oceans. If you take a balloon and rub it against your hair, and then take that statically charged balloon near a tap, running tap of water, the water will bend. This proves that our tides could indeed be caused by the moon's electromagnetic field, or possibly a static electric charge, but not a gravity field. Indeed, if the moon were close enough to pull on our oceans with its measly gravity, the much greater Earth gravity should have pulled the moon into our world a long time ago. This proves the conventional model is totally wrong and not just unlikely. And it proves there's a logically sound, verifiable alternative to the conventional accepted model, which is about as likely as winning the Powerball jackpot 10 times in a row. It's forensically classified as fucking shite, if you want the technical term. In terms of the sun and moon appearing identical in size, it's far more likely that they are relatively nearby and relatively equal in size. We don't need to invent the argument that the sun is 400 times larger and 400 times further away in the flat earth model. So it's a likely fact and not an unlikely major coincidence. To answer the coincidence of gravity being the perfect force to balance the spin of the 1,000 miles per hour near the equator, but is also perfectly adequate to balance us near the North Pole, which is logically asinine, and anyone who continues believing it makes sense doesn't understand physics. At any rate, on the flat Earth, gravity is not necessary. Gravity was a theory dreamed up to explain why we're not flung from the surface of the Earth at 1,000 miles per hour. Since our world is demonstrably not spinning, then we don't need gravity in our model. What goes up must come down is a law of physics. Gravity is a theory necessary only in the globe model. In the flat Earth model, what goes up must come down is explained sufficiently by the simple laws of density and buoyancy. Lighter, less dense objects find their way up, while heavier, denser objects find their way down. It's the natural order of things, and there's no need for gravity to explain it. If you take a beach ball filled with air, for example, and try to hold it underwater, you'll notice that it's difficult to hold it underwater, and it gets more and more difficult the deeper you get. When you let go of the ball, it will race to the surface of the water. So I suppose we should believe that the beach ball is somehow an anti-gravity device. It's beneath the water with all that pressure above it, plus all the gravity, you know, in quotes, gravity pushing down on it. The beach ball should remain underwater according to the theory of gravity. However, it invariably races to the top because it's simply acting in accordance with the natural laws of buoyancy or density. Same thing with a hot air balloon. It's about temperature, density. The North Star Polaris is indeed a proof that the model is wrong and not just a crazy coincidence that needs to be explained in the globe model. You simply cannot argue the North Star could maintain such an alignment for any duration, given our arbitrary, wobbly North Pole in your model. The North Star is simply at the very top of the celestial bodies orbiting above us and has the tightest path around the center. That's the only explanation for how it remains fixed in alignment with our North Pole forever, or for any duration whatsoever. No flights ever traverse the South Pole is more than just a coincidence you need to account for. It's a fact that you cannot argue with, because we indeed live on a flat surface and you simply cannot fly around a globe that doesn't exist. How can you possibly explain the fact that all the relative sizes of continents are wrong in the conventional accepted maps? This is admitted by the mainstream map makers, by the way, so please do not assume this is one of my theories. This is also a fact. The reason that you should see errors in relative size, if the map makers are extrapolating relative distances on the map with the assumption that we live on a globe. The map makers are not trying to deceive us, they're trying to make accurate maps. The problem is they are misinformed, and you can never make an accurate map of the globe, or even an accurate globe of the globe, because we don't live on a globe, we live on a plane. So after all the trillions spent on NASA missions and devices such as Hubble, you would suspect to have literally millions of pictures of our glorious globe Earth, centerfold spread eagle in its obvious sphereness. The fact is, we've only received ever one such picture, and that was actually a fake from NASA. We don't have any pics of the Earth as a globe because it cannot be faked very well. They did a good job on one picture and used that picture in every documentary, textbook, and demonstration for decades. Now all we get are the composite images, which are taken by satellite flyby, wherein we get strips of data, and the strips are composited by Photoshop and wrapped like a texture in a video game around a sphere. The Big Bang is probably the biggest coincidence of them all, and is really a crappy theory for the beginning of the universe. It's actually all wrong, and we can prove that the celestial bodies orbit the center of the plane. The Big Bang is wrong. I've made several videos which prove certain points about the flat Earth. I suggest that you study the topic with an open mind, as there's only one correct answer to this question. Forensically speaking, the globe model is so very unlikely that any good detective wouldn't believe a fucking word the globe says. The globe's story is so full of circumstantial, impossible coincidences, which only prove that the globe is a fucking liar. Our entire world has been misled into believing in a false picture of reality. We've been taught to disregard our observation and our best common sense, discard our discernment. The world's governments have deliberately kept us misled in order to maintain control. Human beings are inherently curious creatures, and so if we knew or even suspected that there might be more land out there, there'd be no stopping us in terms of exploration. Hell, look at the countless billions we spent on the space program, and that was a big circle jerk. So think of how far we could have gone in the last five decades if we'd been pointed in the right direction. Out, not up. Indeed, it's far more likely that the visitors we've been filming with the zero-G, quotes, zero-G craft are coming from nearby and not millions of light years away. One thing's for certain, the fact that they're reported as humanoid only lends credence to the flat Earth. If you can imagine a being traveling from some other galaxy and visiting us, we would have more in common with a garden tomato than we would with this space alien. So the fact that they have two eyes, two arms, and two legs proves that they are somehow related to us. There's no possible way that a space alien in the globe model would be anything remotely similar to us. Similar in size, stature, appearance. I mean, really? You must concur that these are not coming from another galaxy. It's theoretically impossible in your model, and they are a lot like us according to what people are reporting. So what further proof do you need? I mean, if you're into aliens, of course. So there's no way I can cover everything, but I hope that I've helped to point you in the right direction. Indeed, the proof is all out there, but you need to initiate the search on your own. I will never prove anything to you until you decide to break the programming. And that means simply looking at the evidence with an open mind. That's just step one. Thanks.